As a child of God, I need to be working on virtue, that excellence of character. And so therefore, I need to be having my mind in the right place. I need to be thinking about things that are positive. I need to be thinking about things that are right. I need to have the right mindset, because to be honest with you, the other ingredients that we're going to put into our antidote here need to have that right thinking. They need to have that excellent character within my life so that I can add the other things to it. And so he said, the first thing that I need to add to my faith, I need to add virtue. If I am going to add virtue to my faith, I must be sure that I'm thinking upon the right things. Then Peter tells us to add to our faith virtue, and then to virtue, what are we adding? Knowledge. Once you have the right mindset, then true knowledge can be added. You see how it goes hand in hand? Once you have the right, if you don't have the right mindset, if you're not thinking upon things that are true and lovely and just and those types of things, that you are not going to have the right mindset to start adding the knowledge. So if I want to have that knowledge, I want to make sure that I'm building on my faith, and I want to have that excellent character, I want to have the right mindset, so that now I can begin to add the knowledge. And there's a lot of knowledge that I can glean from the Word of God. You see, if I don't have the right mindset, then true knowledge is not going to be able to be added to my life. If I don't have virtue that I've added to my faith, then I can't have knowledge. If I don't have the virtue, then I may succumb to the ignorance or the lack of knowledge. So to my faith, I add virtue. To my virtue, I add knowledge. What's he say next? To knowledge, I am to add temperance. The word temperance means self-control. Self-control. If you have an old Bible, you will probably find in that old Bible, many of the old Bibles had what was called a temperance pledge. Have you ever seen those? And the old Bible has what's called a temperance pledge. And that's where, in that pledge, you pledge yourself to be in control of yourself. And most of the time it has to do with a lot of the vices of the world. I may have virtue and knowledge, but if I don't have self-control, then the devil can put me back into bondage. You see how I'm building? If I am lifted up in self, then I can fall prey to the false teaching. So I have to add to my faith virtue, to my virtue knowledge, and to my knowledge now I need to add temperance. I have to have self-control. Self-control in my life. Then I'm told to temperance, I'm to add what? Patience. What's patience? Well, it's defined as cheerful endurance. Cheerful endurance. I think it's very similar to what the psalmist said in Psalm 27. He said, I had fainted unless I had believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait on the Lord. And then he used this phrase, be of good courage. That's cheerful endurance. That's waiting on God. It's trusting in God and being of good courage. It's having that, you know, Lord, I don't see everything. I'm not where I need to be, and I don't have everything yet, but I'm patiently waiting for you. I'm cheerfully enduring. I'm trusting in you in my life for what I need. So now I'm ready to add to patience. What am I going to add to patience? What does he say? Godliness. Right? So godliness is holiness. Peter wrote to the church in 1 Peter chapter number 1, verse 13, wherefore he said, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to former lusts and your ignorance, but as he which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation, because it is written, be holy for I am holy. So that's the godliness that God wants for me to add. If I try to take that and just add that to my faith at the very beginning, it's like trying to take a kindergartner and put him into sixth grade. That's what Peter's saying. Peter said, here it is, you need to add things to your faith, and there's an order by which he's telling us to add these things. And he said, you need to be diligently working on them. Diligently working on them to add them to your life. So to patience, I add godliness. And to godliness, I add, what's next? Do you have it open? Brotherly kindness. The love of the brethren. Now, I am able to properly add that to I can truly be kind and helpful to others. In fact, the admonition of the Apostle Paul in Ephesians chapter number 4 and verse number 29, he says, let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying. So we're to be building one another up, right? That it may minister grace unto hearers, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed unto the day of redemption. And that he said, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be ye kind one to another, tender hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. So I add brotherly kindness. Now I can finally add to my brotherly kindness the last ingredient that he gives to me there, which is charity. True charity is difficult if you've not built upon your faith these things. You say, well, I can love. I can have charity. I don't know, but I think it's something that's difficult because in 1 Corinthians, Paul said, charity suffereth long and it is kind. Charity envieth not, charity vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up, doth not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not evilly provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth, beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Charity never faileth. I don't know that that's so easy. I don't know that as a young Christian where I've put my faith and trust in Jesus Christ, that the next day I can walk out and say, okay, well, I can have charity. Peter said you got to build some things on your faith. To get to that spot where that last ingredient, which is charity, there's some things that have to come before it. What did he say? Charity will never fail. That led Peter to write, after charity in our text, verse number 8, for if these things be in you, what things is he talking about? He's talking about those things he just gave to us. Faith, virtue, knowledge, temperance, all of those things, right? He said, for if these things be in you, you've been diligently working. You've been diligently adding them to your faith. You've been working hard to make sure you've built one upon another, to get to the spot where you have all of these things in your life. He said, if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor what? Unfruitful, here it is, in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. So this is the antidote for ignorance. So I can always have a fruitful life in the knowledge of God if these things abound in my life. The psalmist wrote in Psalm chapter number 1, verse number 1, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. It's the very same thing. He said, if these things, if you have the knowledge of God, which we've talked about that this morning, I'm going to get that from the Bible. If I have that, I am not going to be barren. I'm going to be fruitful in my life. My leaf is not going to wither, and whatsoever I do is going to prosper for God. But that's not all. Because Peter goes on to tell us, look at verse number 9. But he that lacketh these things, and I always see the flip side of it. But he that lacketh these things is blind, and cannot see afar off, and have forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. So we talked about that this morning. And the unsaved world is in spiritual blindness, but the child of God is in spiritual bondage. He doesn't realize where he is. He's that that old frog in water, and they, you know, the water's cool when he gets in, and it starts boiling and boiling. He doesn't realize he's being boiled to death, right? He said he didn't realize where he was. Why? Because there was ignorance. He'd forgotten all of those things. The knowledge was not there anymore. And where was he? He was in spiritual bondage. Then he said in verse number 10, wherefore? So he gave us the two sides of it. He said, wherefore the rather? Between the two, right? So between the two things here, of these things, he says here, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. I like this. For if ye do these things, ye shall what? Never fall. Once I have built upon my faith to the pinnacle of charity, which never fails, then I can always be fruitful in the knowledge of God, and I will never fall. Fall to what? What's Peter talking about? He's talking about the false teaching. So then the antidote for ignorance and that spiritual bondage, if I want to be taken out of that, and I want to protect myself from that, guess what? What does Peter say here? Peter said, and this is the key, guys, I understand tonight, I'm having a hard time getting my own self going here tonight. I understand that. But please, 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 please don't let this, the foolishness of the old preacher standing up here this evening, deteriorate from the truth of what I'm trying to show you, because this is a vital truth for you in your Christian life, and I promise you that. This is what you need to be seeing, because Peter's giving us something here that's vitally important for us. We're talking about coming to the spot where we never fall. Folks, I want to tell you something. This is vitally important. He said, if we do these things, I have diligently worked in my life, I'm diligently adding them, I've put them in there, I've brought them to the place where all of these things in my life are abounding. He said, when you get to that spot, you won't be unfruitful in the knowledge of God, and you will never fall. We fall when we're in bondage to ignorance. Peter goes on to write in verse number 12. Wherefore, I will not be negligent to put you always in remembrance of these things. Do you think that Peter thought this was pretty important? He said, I'm not going to be negligent. He said, you may not like it. You may not like what I'm trying to tell you. He said, you may not agree, but I'm telling you, this is vitally important. And he said, so I'm not going to be negligent. He said, I have a responsibility here, so I'm going to tell you, and I'm going to constantly remind you of these things. Though you know them and be established in the present truth. Verse 13, yea, I think it meet as long as I am in this tabernacle, he's talking about his body, to stir you up by putting you in remembrance, knowing that shortly I must put off this tabernacle, even as our Lord Jesus Christ hath showed me. He said, you know what? It's so important that until the day I die, he said, I'm going to keep reminding you of these things. Peter saw it. He saw the importance of it. He saw the false teaching. Christ told him it was going to come. Peter was there. Peter saw the false teaching. He saw the ignorance of people. He saw what was happening. He saw their bondage. He said, listen, guys, there's some things that we've got to do here. He said, and here they are. And until the day I die, with my last breath, I'm going to keep reminding you of these things. Because, dear Christian, the Christian life is not just one day I knelt on the ground and I prayed and I asked Christ to save me and that was the end of it for me, that I could just get up and go about my life now and everything was going to be hunky-dory. And if the preachers are preaching that to you, they're absolutely wrong. for those of us who have been a Christian for any length of time, we know the troubles, we know the trials. The Apostle Paul told us himself, he said, the things in my life that I know that I'm not supposed to do. He said, every single day I struggle with my flesh. Every single day I struggle with that sin nature. Every single day I want to yield myself to the Spirit of God. There is a battle that completely and continuously is taking place in my life. And so therefore, Peter said, I understand these things. And so what needs to happen, because the false teachers are out there and they're trying to allure you and they're trying to destroy you, he said, I'm going to keep reminding you, because what you need to do is you need to add these things in your life. The knowledge of God is important. That's what's going to help you when you turn the radio on and a preacher's telling you something and you say, oh, well, that sounds pretty good, but I've never heard that before. If you hear from the pulpit something and you hear me say something, you say, oh, that's interesting, but I've never heard that before, then my suggestion to you is you get in the Word of God and you find it out for yourself. Is it true? Is it right? There's false teaching everywhere. And Christianity is in bondage today to false teaching. That's one of the things that I have found. I have been in the ministry now, in some form of the ministry, for 25 years. And it's one of the things in the period of time that I have served the Lord as a Sunday school teacher, as a youth pastor, as all these different ministries. In the last probably 5 years that I've been in the ministry, it is amazing the amount of time I've had to spend answering people's questions of things that they've heard on the TV, on the radio, or over the internet that is so far offline, it's so far away from the Word of God that people are preaching and they're teaching, and I've spent so much time, a whole file on my computer of stuff that I have been studying, and I try my best, if somebody asks me a question, if you ask me, I try my best to say, I'll get back with you, write it down, I study it, I write it out so that I can give it to you in written form. You can study it for yourself. Look up the scriptures and find it out for yourself. But over the last 5 years, the things that we have been going through in Christianity, the false teaching that's running rampant through Christianity is really coming to the forefront. And Simon Peter had the similar thing taking place in his day, and he looked at it, and what was it? He said, beware of the false teachers. Make sure you have the knowledge of God in your life, folks. Make sure you understand the Bible. Make sure you understand what it says. Don't believe it because I say it. It's not sufficient for you in your Christian life to walk in the door of Beacon Baptist Church on a Sunday morning and a Sunday night and a Wednesday night and listen to me stand up here and spew and say that's all that I need in my life of the Word of God, because that's not what you need. It's there to help you, and it's there to guide you. The preaching is supposed to render apparent, but we, each of us, have a responsibility to the knowledge of God ourselves. We have a responsibility to study the Word of God and to know the Word of God ourselves in our own life. Because if we don't, we are going to fall prey. I know a lot of Christians to whom were solid Christians, godly Christians. I know of pastors today who have gone away from the truth of the Word of God, and they've taken false teaching and they have embraced it. So don't ever think that it's above us or beyond us, that we've reached that place. We have to be so careful that we know the Word of God. We know we have the knowledge of God in our life. Why? So that we don't fall to the false teaching. And Peter said, if you want to be fruitful and you don't want to ever fall, he said, I'm going to give you a formula. Here are some things. These things you must add to your faith. And if you will add these things to your faith, he said, you're not going to be barren or unfruitful. He said, you're not going to fall. You're going to make it. You're not going to succumb to the false teaching. You're not going to go to the error of the wicked. You're not going to fall from your own steadfastness, we read this morning. But he said, listen, guys, you got to be diligent. He said, it's so important. He said, till the day I die, with the last breath I have, I'm going to keep reminding you of these things. those things that you add to your faith virtue, the virtue knowledge. And see, I'm going to keep telling you this. I'm going to keep preaching it to you. I'm going to keep showing you that. He said, you've got to do this in your life so that you are stable. You have a stability in your life so that when the false teaching comes, you're not going to fall to it. You're not going to fall to it. The false teachers have gotten far too many Christians. And what's really sad about it is the fact that most of the time when somebody walks away in false teaching from the church, and I've seen this, in fact, I can't even think of a time that even goes against what I'm going to say here, is it only lasts for a short period of time, and they become disgruntled, and they don't do anything anymore. They don't go to church anymore, any church. They don't study any Bible anymore. They don't do anything anymore. They give up on everything. And in fact, what I find is most of them become cynical. Right? Spiritual bondage. Peter gives us the antidote. I love verse 15. I'll finish up here. It says, moreover, I will endeavor that ye may be able, after my decease, to have these things always in remembrance. He said, even after I'm gone. So I'm going to go to my last breath. And then after I'm gone, and verse 16 says, for we have not followed cunningly devised fables. We made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received from God the Father honor and glory when there came such a voice to him from the excellent glory. This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And this voice which came from heaven we heard, and we were with him in the holy mount. We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well that ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, till the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Peter, I think, lays it out beautifully for us. Where our answers are, God's given it to us, but we have to know it. We have to know it, and it takes work. We have to be diligent. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, I hope and pray that tonight, that Father, your word has gone forward in a way that will have edified and built up and instigated your children to really know what your word says, have the knowledge of you in their life, so that they don't fall to the error of the wicked. Father, my heart's prayer and desire is for every person in this room here to have the full assurance of the truth in their own heart and their own life, from the word of God, not from what someone's told them. There not be one person here in this room that would fall to the false teachers. And so, Lord, I pray and ask that these things in which you gave to us in your word, this what I called an antidote, a formula, whatever it is you gave us, these words, these things, they're important. They're an important part of the life of the child of God. Help us to understand them, diligently implement them into our life. Every head is bowed and every eye is closed. The piano will play, and as it does, the old-fashioned altar is open. Thank you. have your attention right up here for just a moment. We'll stand together. We're going to be dismissed in a word of prayer. And I hope to see you back on Wednesday evening to enter our Bible study. Brother Andreas, would you close the service out tonight, please?